What's up, y'all? My name's Shaquan, but a lot of people know me by my other name, Mad Skills. I'm an MC.
My name is Mad Skills. Paris, make some noise.
I'm a DJ. I'm a ghostwriter for some of your favorite rappers. I'm not about to tell you who, though. But most importantly, I'm a hip-hop enthusiast. Hip-hop changed my life.
Hip-hop, you the love of my life, and that's true.
I love everything about the culture, just like you do. Hip-hop Confessions is raw, unfiltered conversations with my friends revealing things that they didn't like, never knew about,
I don't know,
or never got into about hip-hop culture. These are conversations I have all the time anyway. It's just that now, the microphone is on. Hopefully, there's some of the most honest and entertaining stories that you'll hear. So sit back.
Well, come on, y'all.
Turn up the volume.
Hip-hop.
And listen to Hip-hop Confessions. Because everybody's got one.
Here's a little story that must be told.
And it goes a little something like this.
Yo, what's up, y'all? It's your boy, Mad Skills. We here. We back. This is Hip-Hop Confessions, because everybody got one. My brand new podcast, which is used to be a show, but now it's a podcast. It is weird. Anyway, I got two of my best friends in the house right now. I'm going to introduce them one at a time. One of them, you already know this guy. He is a engineer extraordinaire.
Legendary.
Legendary Howard alumni. Delaware legend. Jersey legend. Y'all give it up for my man in the building, Young Guru. What's up, bro?
I appreciate y'all, man. I appreciate y'all. Glad to be here. Let's go.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes,
the legendary. You heard his name a million times. Yo, Goo. You know what I mean? Guru.
Good to see y'all, man.
Yeah, man. Likewise. Second up, man. Listen, this guy is probably one of my biggest influences in life. A lot of people always tell me, you know, no, Skills, like you the illest songwriter out of Richmond, Virginia. No, it's another person from Richmond, Virginia that is way more legendary than me, written way more songs than me. You often hear him, but you hardly ever see him. He's like a ghost in this industry. I can't believe I got him here. Ladies and gentlemen, y'all give it up for the magnificent Harold Lilly, Grammy Award winning.
Yes, sir.
Harold
yes,
Lilly sir. Jr. Yes, in the building.
Yes, thank sir. You, bro. Thank
How you doing, man? You good?
Hey, dog, my OG interviewing me on a podcast with motherfucking Guru, shawty.
Oh, hey, my brother.
Hey, Skills, how long we go back? I was 13 when I met you?
Yeah, 13, 14 years old.
You played me. You the first person played me Jodeci, dog.
Yes.
Wow.
And hey. Biggie.
Wow.
Wu-Tang.
And Method Man.
Me all that
that got to be special, though, coming from where y'all come from.
So
first time you heard Jodeci.
Facts.
Yeah, because that shaped his whole life. Damn. You got to understand, I go to New Music Seminar in 93
right.
to do the battle. Jay outside smashing niggas. You know what I'm saying? I'm on the block. We fresh from Richmond. Keisha from Total gives me a hamburger fucking case with a tape in it, and it says Big Mac.
Yeah.
Oh.
We listened to that shit all the way back down 95.
Yeah.
Listen to Flavor in Your Ear. Yeah. I think it's 4 songs off of Flavor in Your Ear and 4 songs off of Ready to Die. Soon as I get back to Richmond, the first person that get in my car is him.
Wow.
And I'm like, yo, you gotta listen to this tape.
I remember those like yesterday, man.
Yeah.
I remember the Big Mac promos like yesterday.
With paper lettuce and a real bun. And the tape. And I remember holding that shit in my hand, because I already had a crush on Keisha from Total. So when she gave it to me, I was like, yo. And I remember holding that shit in my hand, I was like, yo, this gotta be the great. Whoever came up with this is a fucking genius.
Puff is a marketing genius, man. He's a marketing genius. I remember that time back then, man. That was crazy. I remember when I was on campus and he came in and had a meeting in Blackburn, I believe it was. And he said, basically, like a Who Wanna Roll meeting.
Right.
And that was the start of Bad Boy. I'll never forget it.
Who Wanna Roll meeting?
Like basically, Puff was at Uptown. And he had got fired from Uptown.
Right.
Right. So he was at Howard on some, yo, this is what I'm doing. This is my next move. I remember, I think either Harv or
D-Dot.
Dot was definitely in there. But I'm trying to remember who invited me.
Right.
It might have been either Harv or Ann Hubbard or somebody like that had invited me to this little thing. Like, yo, you know, see if you want to do this.
Right.
Because at the time, it was like you was on campus. You volunteered for, like, Def Jam or whatever.
Right.
You know what
right,
I mean?
Right,
little
right.
things like that.
Okay.
I was just trying to be around
getting
industry
promo
things.
Shit.
Yeah.
So trying to get records.
I remember he had a postcard with him with no shirt on, standing on the Jersey side, looking at New York over the water with a chain on backwards. Like the chain was, you could see it on his back. And I remember that was like the postcard. Then I remember, you got to remember Craig Mack was first. Craig Mack was the lead artist.
Yep.
And Craig Mack was the one getting a little, and then he put that thing together. And I remember those promos, it was called Big Mack. And the pictures was them like in a fast food restaurant.
Yeah.
It had like songs or titles on the back or whatever.
Yeah, it was like they was behind the counter. Legendary picture of Big Craig and Puff. I wish I kept that, man.
I wish I kept a lot from
I wish
back
I
then.
Kept that. You know what I'm saying?
I wish I kept a lot
Jesus
from back
Christ.
Then. Yeah.
So listen, man, the show is Hip Hop Confessions where we reveal, you know, stories or, you know, opinions about things that we've never really told anyone. So with that being said, we're going to start off with Young Guru first. Guru.
Yeah.
I need your hip hop confession, brother.
I got to think about this one, man. Something I never told nobody.
Or your opinion about something that, you know, you might not, you know, might not be privy. I remember my first one was, and it's still up in the air. People still give me a lot of shit about it. I had never listened to an Outkast album.
Wow.
Ever.
Wow.
That wow. But that was 10 years ago. Being from Richmond, I was heavily East Coast influenced. So you got to understand, 93, 94, I was listening to everything coming down the turnpike. Like Black Moon, Nas, J. Rue the Damage, a Gangstar, then Biggie, then Wu. Like anything that was coming up, we was like, nah, we cool on that. You know what I'm saying? So I never really listened to an Outkast album. If they had a video for it, of course, I see Elevators, you know what I'm saying? Rosa Parks, you know what I'm saying? Southern Playlistic. I was familiar with the song, but I had never physically owned an Outkast album. Wow. And then somebody was like, nah, Skills, you out of line, nigga, you out of pocket. And somebody sent me this is when CDs were still in. Like, so I first made this confession in 2009, 10. Somebody sent me the box set of everything. And I can still say it's 2020.
You ain't listened to
and
it.
And I still ain't listened to a whole
you
Outkast.
Gotta listen, you gotta listen
you gotta
to
listen
that
to
AT
that,
Aliens.
Man.
You gotta listen to that AT Aliens. Like,
I haven't.
I tell you this. My whole philosophy and mindset changed in 92.
Okay.
Because
here we go.
I go from doing parties in my area, right? So I know exactly what people in Delaware, Philly, you know what I mean, DC.
Right.
Here, Jersey, because
right.
That's my influence. So I'm in Delaware. I'm doing those parties. When you go to Jersey, you got to include the house music or what we call club
right.
music.
Club music,
Jersey.
Baltimore.
Always
yeah.
been good. You know what I mean? Big with us. You go to Baltimore, it's a different form of it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then D.C. with the go-go, right? So all of that was my upbringing and what I knew. The minute I stepped on Howard's campus and now I got to do parties for people from all 50 states
yep.
and Jamaica and London. And
you got to think.
It made my whole mindset open up, and it wasn't like hecklers. These are actually my friends, and some of them is from Inglewood, California. And they're like, yo, where the West Coast music at?
Right,
good.
Right, come on.
And
right.
Some of them's from down south, and some of them's from Miami. And they're like, yo, you ain't gonna play no bass music?
Nice.
Like, it was just me servicing my friends. So my mind started to open up, and you get into them conversations where I had people from Texas that will argue you Scarface is the greatest MC. And you know,
ever.
In 1992,
yes. Facts.
They will argue you that Scarface is the greatest MC ever. And back then it was like, if anybody was better than KRS-One, you just lying to yourself. Right?
Right.
92, I'm
right,
saying.
Right, 92.
So those battles and those arguments and then having cats from Brooklyn that would sort of argue you that Pac is the best.
Right.
Like all these different pockets is what made me listen. So when the first Outkast album came out, I was like, yo, this is dope. And I got it. Well, I got a promo, and it's one of them, like, you just get it. You know, at that point, it was like I was getting records sent to
right.
me. I got that promo for Elevators, and it was over. I was like, yo, what is this? And then I listened to that AT Aliens album, and it just caught me. It was everything.
Right.
Andre was everything, the way he was talking.
Right.
You know, my sort of, that thing that we ride, you know, in the middle pause, where it's just like, yo, you're not trying to be outside busting a gun, but you also not a sucker neither.
Right.
So it's
right.
just like he's talking my lane of like grown man at the time where I thought was grown man, but like
right.
that thing, Outkast, I've been a huge fan ever since. And I think him and Big Boy's balance is sort of that same balance as like Fife and Q-Tip.
Right.
Right. We need that. You need those opposites.
Right. Now, for me, I was discovered by Q-Tip. So I was a huge Tribe Called Quest fan before. Mm. You know what I'm saying? I tell cats all the time, like, me and Pharrell was probably the biggest Tribe Called Quest fans in Virginia. Like, nigga, right. I could tell you where the drums came from on Kenneck, like all of that shit. So for me, I already had my duo. You know what I'm saying? From People's Indistinctives. And what nothing gonna ever change that for me. So I done been in barbershop arguments, you know what I'm saying? The whole shit, like, come on, Skills, like, you, a nigga like you is hip hop influencer. And I'm like, yeah, I just wasn't on it.
I'll tell you one thing, Skills. I hated Left My Wilder Than El Segundo.
Is that your confession?
I hated that song. You know why? Because I was like, why did they pick this song as the single? I was like, it's so I'm thinking of everything else, and I'm like,
yeah,
why that song? I Left My Wilder Than El Segundo off that album. I was like, yo, this is what y'all sat in the, because you know back then you're not in the industry all the way yet,
right?
And then, but you sitting there in them barbershops having them conversations as if you are, because you was the guy that's trying to do it, so people look at you like that. And you would, if that was my thing, if I was picking first singles, I would have went. You know, you talk so much garbage, and you don't know what you're talking about, right? Right. I was like, yo, I hate this song. Why did they choose?
So is that
this
it? Is
one?
That the hip hop confession?
That's one of them. I hate it. I'm a huge, you know what I mean?
Love of course.
It was more or less me saying, yo, why did they choose that song to come with first?
Right.
Like, you because have Bonita Applebum on that album.
The singles, the singles off of that album was Can I Kick It, yeah, Bonita Applebum. Yeah. Because it almost seemed like El Segundo could have fucked up the bag.
Yeah.
Because if they was on the label that I was on and that shit came out first, and it won't no response, and like, nigga, you're not even getting a second single.
Right. And that was happening a lot back then.
Yeah, you couldn't get it. You gotta keep going.
But, you know, they turned out to be what they are, and then they did the thing that nobody else could really do, which is that sophomore album is better than the freshman.
Yes. The sophomore album was better than the freshman album. Yeah. Because there's no question that Low End Theory tops People's Indistinctive Travels.
I interviewed Bob Power one time, and I was like, why does this sound so much better?
Right.
And he was like, the equipment got better. That was his whole answer to me. He was like, yo, the equipment got better. Q-Tip stayed on me about, you know what I mean, certain things about why they... I think by this time, people know that, like, Tip and Pos is the ones, like, at the board.
Right.
You understand? With Bob when it comes to that sort of thing. Not to say anybody else didn't do anything else. But
those two was always
that's
there.
The
Every
stories
song.
I hear with Bob about, you know, possibles. And for me having mixed a De La Soul album, I fully understand.
Yes. Right.
When we in there, Pos is the one right next goo. I want it just like this. I want my delay like this. I want very specific scientists on how he wants his sound.
Right.
But Bob just told me, he was just like, yo, the equipment got better. So then it was just like that album just sonically just... That's still an album that I reference to this day between Chronic 2. Like, if I walk in a room to mix and I've never been in that room, like, I gotta learn it.
You play.
I play Low End Theory and I play Chronic 2001.
Wow. Yeah. Wow.
Those are my tests.
It's funny because when I DJ gigs and I'm in a room and I want to hear the room, the first song I play is Next Episode.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Know where you at. You gotta know where you at.
If Next Episode sound good in the room, then I got a good feeling about how people going to be able to differentiate and decipher this music that I'm going to play later on tonight. Yeah. If I'm in Japan or some shit and I play Next Episode. Yeah, man. Yeah. Now, that's a big thing, man. Like,
yeah, that's how I test out rooms, is just playing songs I know, you know, and then try to figure out, like, what the frequency of the rooms is. But that's
so you hated it. You hated
El Segundo. Yeah, I hated El Segundo. I absolutely hated that record. I thought it was just like, why would you lead with that? That was my whole point. But then I love Tribe. You know, Jerobi has, over the years, become like a really, really close, really good friend of mine.
Right.
Like, I jump in front of a truck for Jerobi. Like,
right.
That's my guy.
A good dude, too. A good dude. Just, you know what I'm saying? Like, I remember, you know, when I met Tip, and it was almost like meeting a god, you know what I'm saying? Because I heard his voice so much. I listened to him so much. Mm-hmm. So when I met him at that Jack the Rap in Atlanta, and... The nigga, like, this is after People's Indistinctive Travels. This is after Low End, but it's right before Midnight Marauders.
Mm.
So I'm rapping, and the nigga like, yo, you ill, son. Like, you ill. Like, and I'm like, yo, that's what's up. He's like, yo, where you from? And I was like, from Virginia. He's like, oh, where? That's crazy. He's like, yo, you want to come up? He said, you want to go roll to this radio station with me? So I was like, fuck yeah. Like, she's like, all right, we going to go upstairs real quick. So I'm like, all right, so we hop in the elevator, and we go upstairs. He like, I got a change. So I walk into a room. I might have been like the first time I seen a suite. Like, first time I just won a room. Like, nigga had a whole fucking suite and shit at the land of Marriott Marquis. So I walk into the room, and he like, yo, I'm going to change real quick. And he go into the bathroom, and it's a little boombox sitting on the table. And the nigga hit the button and say, yo, tell me what you think. This is the album. And the nigga walked out. And I heard, And then the ladies start talking. You know what I'm saying? A Tribe Called Quest. That's and I'm dope. Sitting there like,
that's dope.
Nah, this can't be what I think it is. Like, so I'm like, maybe he's just playing me some jazz shit. Like, I don't know what the fuck going on. And I'm sitting there like, what is happening? Like, damn, this nigga just left me. And then all I hear is, ta-da-da. Then I just hear Fife go, Linden Boulevard. And I was like, nigga. Oh, my God. Like, I was blown. Like, nigga, I was blown.
Had to be.
So I'm listening to Steve Biko. And I'm losing my shit. Like, I'm hearing Tribe's album before it comes out. And I think I heard the next song. I think the next song might have been a War Tour. And then I think I heard Hey Sucker Niggas. Like, and then Hey Sucker Niggas comes on, and he come out the bathroom dressy, fresh, ready to go and shit. He like, yo, what you think of that shit, son? And I was like, I had no words. Like, I just had no words. Like, I was so done. And we get in the elevator. Elevator stops, and then we stop on like another floor, and Lytro get in the elevator.
He's the Lytro.
I met him, and then we walk outside. It's a van waiting outside to take us to Georgia Tech or whatever radio station we was going to. We get in the van, and I asked the nigga to take a picture with me right before we get in the van. The picture's is on my grandma's shit. We get in the van, and in the back row of the van is Posse and Merce.
Wow.
I mean, Posse and Maceo. So I'm like, nigga, I'm in a fucking van with two-thirds of De La Soul and Q-Tip, and this nigga turned around to Posse like, yo, it's my man Skills, you know what I'm saying? It's nigga ill, son. Posse like, where you like, yo, nut, son, nigga ill, crazy,
so he
son.
Just, he did all that just based off of hearing you off rhyme
hearing
one
time.
Off
hearing me rhyme in a lobby in Atlanta, Jack the Rapper.
Wow.
And fucking, I go, and when we going upstairs, he said, yo, say that same shit you was saying in the lobby, son. Word. Say that same shit. Wow. So I'm like, all right. So I rap. Shit went off well. I leave. We leave. We go back in the van. We go. I done left my niggas. My niggas have no clue where I am. I done just left these niggas. They walking around Atlanta, like, got back. They got passes, but they like, yo, where's this nigga at? This pre-cell phone, all that shit.
Right.
I get back. We get back, and the nigga say, yo, let me get your number, son. And I was like, all right. So I give him the house number.
Of course.
80, I give him the house number.
That would you if you was doing it a little bit, you might have had a pager. They was starting to come out, but you had to give somebody your house number.
Facts. Right. I give him the house number, go back to Virginia. A week later, I'm coming in from work from MCV. I was working at the parking deck. My mom says, somebody named Rip left you a message. Rip. I said, who? Said, somebody named Rip left a message. I said, I don't know nobody named Rip. She said, yo, it's on the machine. I hit the machine.
It's
a tip. Nigga said, yo, son, hey, yo, this is Q-Tip, you know what I'm saying? Calling for my man, Mad Skills. Hey, if you get this message, son, call me back. 917, whoop-de-whoop-de-whoop. And the nigga says, yo, I'm trying to see, I'm trying to see how far you live from Hampton, Virginia. Hit me back, son. Nigga, and I knew at that moment, I was like, my life can possibly change. At that moment, I go to, and fast forward, but that's the same shows where I met Pharrell in the parking lot.
Yo, that's crazy.
You know what I'm saying?
Those just instant moments.
Yeah.
That's crazy. I don't know if I had an instant moment, bro. I planned it.
Right.
And kept working and working and working and working the plan. Like, right. I don't have not one... I don't know if I have one distinct moment. I would say maybe the day I met Jay was probably a distinct moment, but it was like little seeds that had already been planted before that.
Right.
But even still, it was like, I don't know. It's just everything for me was a work to plan thing for a long, long time. Like, I had to really make a plan and be like, this is what I'm going to do. I made a plan to DJ, and I made a plan to be like, okay.
Right.
My freshman year, they used to throw this hip-hop conference down there. They had this thing called Culture Initiative, right? And they used to throw the hip-hop conference on the campus of D.C. I mean, on Howard's campus.
Yeah.
So they bring a whole bunch of this was when Raz was involved. I don't want to miss anybody. My man Tim, who ends up being my first manager, was involved. Again, I don't have no money, so right. I'm going there and I'm like, all right, I'll volunteer, help y'all stuff badges and put the thing together. Right. If I could get a badge to get into the conference.
To the joint, of course.
This is when, access. Like, they mimicking the Jack the Rappers of the world, the new music seminars. Right. Yeah. That's what you know what I mean, bringing it all. My first year, Pac was there with the 555 Soul on, jumping around. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Walking around with, like, Freddie Fox and Biz and, like, all of those people. That was my first time, like, because I was working for them, they gave me a car and be like, yo, go pick up the Lost Boys from the airport.
Right.
So it's like I go, you know what I mean, drive.
Right.
You know what I mean? Suit is sitting there, Charles Suit is sitting there with the Lost Boys, get all of them, bring them back to campus. I was just doing, but it was allowing me to meet people. Mm-hmm. At the same time still DJing, but all of that was like calculated. Then from that I entered the DJ competition that year and won. So then that's when what would end up being my crew, like Tracy Lee.
Right, RNF.
Yeah, RNF, Midi, everybody. Midi was the one who stepped to me.
What
the like,
nigga named Pi in that crew?
Pi is my dude.
I used
dude.
To fuck with that nigga.
Nah, he's the one that does the uh-huh on
Tracy's
the theme.
They had a song called Take the Train.
Take the Train.
That was on it was on a Universal sampler that I got.
So, I don't know if you know, but Trey was signed. Dino was our A&R.
And when you say Trey, you're talking about Tracy Lee.
Tracy Lee made it. He got signed to Universal.
Right.
He put out a song called The Theme.
Yes. Right? Dino, one of my favorite records.
Dino was our A&R.
It was called The Theme?
The Theme.
Yeah, you know, and everywhere that my crew goes.
It's also called It's Party Time.
Party Time. It's Party Time. You remember that record. Yeah,
So then Dino had Rakim as another artist.
Uh-huh.
And then Dino finds this group called Cash Money.
Wow. This Dino DeVelli or something, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, right. So he signs Cash Money. So after the Cash Money signing, it was a little difficult for us to get Dino on the phone.
Right.
So then,
we had
a group called The Reaps who was working on an album who was going to be like another subset of our crew that actually did get a deal. But then rest in peace, my dude Feeb got killed in the Bronx, and that kind of like squashed the whole group thing. But
they was
another one that was just about to come. That's why Pi was on Trey's record. He's actually on the remix with Busta 2, the theme remix, mm-hmm. doing all the uh-huhs.
Yep.
But that was our crew. So we had a crew that was at Howard, and then whoever they was affiliated with at home in New York, that was our crew too.
Right.
So okay,
we
got
had
it.
Yeah, we had
by association,
networks.
Of course.
So if you look at RNF, we from Delaware, Philly, D.C., New York.
Right.
Wow. All the members and Jersey.
Right.
Wow. Right. All the members is from there. So then Mike, who's with Mid, Midi is Roz Baraka's younger brother. Mike and Mid was a group called One Step Beyond that was almost signed to Bad Boy. Like, we went through the whole thing of, like, making demos, giving them to Derek, right. giving them to Puff, giving right. them to everybody. That was our normal thing. We would DJ parties or throw parties. I'm DJing. All the money as a collective, nobody took no money off the party.
Right.
Because back then you had to spend for studio time. So that money became studio time. It became whether you got to buy reels, ADATs right. at a certain point.
Right.
You know, all of those things. Like, as a crew, we started putting back into ourselves.
That's what we did.
Yeah, so we could record. That's how Trey, you know what I mean, was rocking. That's how all of us
ADAT machines and shit.
It was a collective. It was a collective effort. So it was like, I got four other parties during the week that's going to pay my bills. This one is for the crew.
Right.
It's for us to as a family. That's what I said. Everything was pretty much planned out. Then the one thing that did happen by accident is I was outside. LS1 has been my dude for a long time.
Yeah, yeah,
right? LS1, if you know, he DJed for DMX, DJ for Onyx.
Okay. Yeah.
One of those people.
Great DJ, too.
One of those people that I would say in my lifetime, like, took me to another level.
Mm.
Like, when I was at, I'm talking about in terms of turntablism, scratching, mm-hmm. how to approach parties, how mm-hmm. to, like, just how to rip. But not get boring to where you overdoing it and thinking you in the DMX, you know what I'm
right.
saying, like competition at that time.
Right.
How to do the party and incorporate both of those. Long story short, we used to practice together a lot. And we was at this Rap Page. Remember Rap Pages? That was a newspaper?
Sheena Lester.
They had a conference in D.C. So I'm outside and I'm sitting out there just smoking. And this dude walks up and was like, yo. To LS. He was like, yo, you know any DC DJs? I need somebody in DC. I got a girl act, but I need the DJ to be from here because I don't want to be flying, you know what I'm saying? Somebody from New York in and out. Right. And like, he was like, yo, my man right here is ill. So
wow.
In that one moment.
Was this your
This is my dude Derek, who was managing this girl named Nonchalant. Right? Mm. He's like, yo, let me audition you. So he comes to Six in Florida, to the hood, right? Six in Florida.
Mm-hmm.
I auditioned for him. That Friday, I was on stage with Nonchalant, and we was opening up for the Fugees.
Yeah.
That's how fast that happened.
I love stories
that's my,
like
that's
that,
my
96.
That's, that happened to me in 96.
Yeah.
So I go through that. We do a couple little, like, I don't know, you know, the small shows, you know what right. I mean? The spot dates.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We end up on another show with the Fugees in Florida, right, again. And then Clef just came over real like, yo, y'all want to open up for us on the European tour?
Wow.
We was like, what? Right. And this is Ready or Not tour.
Right.
Yeah. Like the Fugees,
they
is
was
just
blew
they
hot.
Was on their, yeah, they was it, on their rise out of yeah. the Booth Bath era.
Right.
And they had just killed the United States. And now it's the rise. And they like, we about to go do the European leg of this. Ready or Not, 96.
Score.
I've never had a passport. Yeah, the score.
Yeah.
I've never had a passport in my life. Now is the time where Nas like, okay, we going over there. Now it flips from us doing these little spot dates, you arguing with the sound man, to like we're on a bus. This is my first
right.
time being on a bus, on a tour bus, and being
right.
like, oh my God.
Wow.
Right. Like, this is amazing. This yeah. is my first time walking into where the bus drives into the venue. And
you get off and you're
yeah,
right there
you're
by,
right
by
there.
Backstage. Yeah.
And then you get up there and I'm talking to the sound man. And he's like, hey, you know, everybody's nice. And he's
yeah.
he's got like a computerized EQ that has my name on it. And he's yeah. setting my left. I'm used to arguing with sound man, you know what I'm saying? In West, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
In
it's
West
different.
Nowhere, Toledo. Like, I'm like, right. you know, like I'm used to that. So the whole thing was shocking me. And
right.
I had never seen hip hop on that level.
Right, exactly.
Life.
Exactly.
Seen it. That's
right.
when I was like,
world
oh,
shit.
This could be my job.
That's dope.
This could definitely
that's
be
dope.
My job.
It's
it was
big.
96.
It's
it went
big.
From, okay, local DJ in DC, somebody that's DJing. Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm putting together raps. My crew's trying. Trey didn't get on until 97. 96 was when I went with
Nonchalant.
Shit,
so I kind of like left the crew. And everybody was,
that.
They blessing was like, yo, go, please go do it. You know what I'm
right,
saying? So
right,
then I come
right.
home and I got a couple dollars in my pocket.
That's
right.
So then I was like, all right, cool. Now I'm going to go to engineering school and lock this down. So I went to school.
Dope.
Nonchalant starts her second album for MCA. And I stepped to Nine and I was like, yo, I know how to engineer. And she was like, for real? I was like, no, I'm dead serious. Like, I know exactly what I'm doing. She was like, okay. She that's my big sister.
Right.
So she's gonna, like, all right.
But the thing about that is she put me with Chucky Thompson. Chucky Thompson was executive producer. Now, you got to remember, Nine was no subsidiary. She signed directly
to MCA. Yeah, she did.
Direct.
Definitely.
It was a direct signing. So she puts me with Chucky, and then that was the introduction to the Bad Boy thing. And from there, it was just on and popping. And Chuck, the first time when he saw me, he was just like, yo, I got to hide you from Puff. And I was like, what you mean? He was like, no, he going to want to take you. From. He was like,
facts.
He's
right.
like you
yeah.
that
he already knew.
So what,
yeah.
Chuck, what Chuck gave me, he was just like, yo, he was like, I'm going to put you in the room with the right people. So the very first time, Chuck did two monumental things.
Mm.
Chuck would not take the session, and he would be like, yo, you got to fly my engineer with me or else I'm not taking the session.
Facts.
So if he got a flight to New York, I
got
a flight
to
New
York.
So then I'm in there, and I'm in there for the recording aspect. So, yeah, I'm meeting Mary, I'm meeting Faith, I'm meeting everybody. But
damn.
Then what Chuck would do is when the mix went down, he'd be like, you might got to fit your own bill, but you sitting in the room with Tony Maserati.
And why?
Learn everything he know.
Right.
Because once you get what he know, they can't have
so,
what you got.
Right. That's dope.
Because you had to live. Because
you grew
that.
Up in it.
Yes.
That's dope. That's dope.
That's the main
Very
thing
critical.
He did. And then I give all that credit to like Tony and all them people. Maserati. They was super
right.
welcoming to me because
right.
I was serious. And I was
right.
like, those sort of opportunities were like the stories of my yo, this one shot thing, but everything else is like super duper
right.
planned out and failures. And you got to keep,
right.
keep
and
going
keep
and keep going
yeah.
and keep pushing and keep
yeah.
pushing. And then just things happen.
Right. Nah, that's dope. That's dope. It's just sometimes we aligned and we don't really know exactly, we don't understand the magnitude of what's happening at that particular time. But
yeah.
when you look back, you're like, yo, I'm so glad I didn't just get frustrated. I just moved out of it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So
I definitely didn't, bro.
Right.
Like, and I wish, as much as we did, as much as we accomplished, I wish I understood my power even greater back then.
Man,
right. Because we had everything.
Right.
We had everything and it was all together.
Right.
Like, so we had, it was nothing for us to say, okay, we throwing this party Friday. We got a dude doing the flyers. That's our graphic artist dude. We had a dude that was making clothes at the given time.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? And it was multiple people on campus with their own clothing line.
It was
like
a
that
whole
was a
village.
Remember Tribe Vibe? Remember all of that thing that was going? Like, that was the whole flavor back then of create your own, start your own label, do your own thing, be independent. We had, like, just all the artists.
That was 90, you said 95, bro, because you left in 96.
Yeah, yeah. I was on campus from 92 to 96.
Dope.
Yeah, 92 to 96.
So, Harold Lilly.
Yes,
listen,
sir.
You are a accomplished songwriter. You've written, man, mm-hmm. I can't, like, Grammy winning, which is so funny because I just seen your Grammy just sitting at your mom's house on the coffee table. She was crazy to me. I go to his mom's house and his Grammy just sitting there. So, like, you know, Alicia Keys, Usher, Beyonce, Brandy, Fantasia, like, Jennifer, it's crazy. It's crazy that I even know you, first of all. Like,
you my OG, dog.
And I've known you for as long as I have.
Yeah.
So I need, because you've written a lot of records, mm-hmm. I need your hip-hop confession. Or not even a hip-hop confession. I just need a musical confession from you.
You know what? No, I'm going to give you a hip-hop confession. My hip-hop confession is, for all the songs that I've written, my musical hip-hop genesis started at, what's the Eazy-E first album? Still Talking?
Easy Does It.
Easy Does It.
That's my Bible.
Mm. Right.
I'm a kid from Richmond, Virginia, churched out, man. I grew up in church.
Right.
I just grew up in church. But all of the decisions that I've made over the years, if it has anything to do with, not writing no raps or nothing.
Right.
But energy guru.
Yeah, man.
I go in that album. So Eazy-E. And a young Dr. Dre, all of them was kids.
Right.
Ice Cube, they making music. I go to a flea market. Go to flea market off of Jefferson Davis Highway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And me and my homeboys, he get a tape. He said, Earl, we got to listen to this. I said, man, I'm going to get in trouble. We got to go to your house.
Right.
He said, no, Earl, look, we'll go to my crib. We'll listen to the tape. And he said, no, we don't got to listen. I got a Walkman. He had a Walkman. And I heard that shit coming in my ears. And they had samples. Like, man, N.W.A. was sampling the
everything.
It's interesting. The Dr. Dre that celebrated. Mm-hmm. That Dr. Dre.
Right.
The Dr. Dre I fell in love with. He was on some Shockley Brothers shit.
That right. was what was going on at the time.
Yeah.
Public Enemy was
yeah.
raining.
Yeah.
Right.
So that shit just kind of seared. Eazy-E, bro. I probably write some of the most greatest songs ever in life. But Eazy-E and Dr. Dre.
Now tell me about the one particular song that we discussed before this.
You talking about the Luther record?
Yes.
Oh.
Luther Vandross, you probably have written.
Guru, I'm 21 years old. I come out to Los Angeles. I do a deal with Big John. He hear a song. He hear one song and signed me. He never met me in my life.
Good dude, man.
Amazing guy. Amazing guy. Put me in the game. So Luther Vandross, I do a demo. Think nothing of it. Get a phone call.
You did songs with, these was like a bunch of songs with Warren.
Yeah, Warren Campbell.
Right.
Shout out to Warren Campbell. My first, that was actually my second time in Los Angeles. Luther Vandross, Clive is starting J Records because he just got kicked out.
Right.
So
right.
now he got this energy like, oh, y'all gonna kick me out? Okay.
I'm gonna show you.
Yeah, so he's starting J Records. And I read about this when you're starting a new label, you just go get Legacy Acts.
Yes. Yeah.
And I read a lot. So girl, we in the bowling alley. We and it's a young Larry Jackson. Larry Jackson is following, getting the game from Clive. He a young A&R. We all trying to figure this shit out, right?
Right.
Bro, write some demos, send it in. I'm at the bowling alley with Warren. Regular day, Warren phone ring. It's Luther Vandross. Mm. Luther Vandross said, hey, man, I want to talk to her, Lily. And so Warren give me the phone, 21.
And he don't even know who you are.
No, he don't know who I am.
He just say, I want to talk to Harold Lilly.
Facts. Book speak for itself.
Yeah, yeah. So then I took the song, man, and got the phone, and he said, listen, Harold, I need a new verse. I said, okay. He said, the first verse is really about women and a woman's physique, and, you know, you are very gender specific. I need this. Luther's bigger than men. Luther's bigger than women. Luther's bigger than all of us.
So he talking to you on the phone about himself in third person.
First time it ever happened to me.
Luther Vandross.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So then he tells me that Luther's bigger than all of it. And I said, okay. He said, I need you to write a verse that's very general. So everybody can understand it. Like what you were saying about the parties. Mm-hmm. So then I said, okay. I said, well, I'll get it to you tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
He said, what did you say? I said, I can get it to you tomorrow. I'm at the bowling alley. I'm not around the studio. He said, oh, okay. He said, all right, what do you want to do with your life? I said, I want to be a songwriter. Do you know any songwriters? Yeah, I know songwriters. Who do you know? Who do you know? Oh, man, Burt Bacharach, Bernie Taupin, man, Diane Warren, David Foster, L.A. Reid, Babyface. Okay. All them want to get on this album. And I'm calling you for a first verse, and you're telling me you're going to get it to me tomorrow?
Because you in the bowling alley.
Because you in the bowling alley. I said, okay, well, I get it to you. I'll get it to you soon.
Because you don't know how you're going to do this.
No, I don't. I don't know, man. I don't know.
You 21 years old.
I've never been asked for a rewrite.
Luther Vandross is on the phone telling you.
And basically what he told me, Guru, set up. That's why I'm here now. What he told me, this conversation set up the next. It put me on a 30-year plan.
Mm-hmm.
Put it that way. Yep. Okay. It put me on a 30-year plan. And he said, Harold, I got a lot of cars. I got a Jaguar. I got a Rolls Royce. I got a Mercedes. He said, if I take any of my cars to the shop and they tell me they can't fix my car, what do you think I'm going to do with my car? I said, you're going to take it across the street. Do you want me to take your song across the street?
Ooh.
Mm. I said, no, sir. I don't.
You got to be respectful because it's Luther.
I love that. You know, you got to love the fact that he's keeping it real with you.
Yes.
Somebody else would have just took somebody else and just went and got
and
another verse.
Right. Went and got another verse. Yeah. And do you know, he started talking to me about the music business and the thing he said that probably a confession of mine. We never talked about this, but he told me, he said, listen, Harold, and I'm going to tell everybody.
Mm. He's talking to you and you wrote the song, and he said, I'm going to tell everybody that I wrote it.
That I wrote the song. And I said, why would you do that? He said, well, how I answer that question can make you more money. And this happened. I saw it on Oprah. He said, I'm going to go on Oprah.
Mm-hmm.
And Oprah going to ask me a question. The way I answer that question going to make you more money. I said, okay.
Mm.
He said, the question is this. Oh, Luther, oh my God, we love the song. How did the song happen? Oh, this guy named Harold Lilly from Richmond wrote it. Next question.
Right.
That wasn't too spicy.
Right.
So Skiz, he said, the next way I can answer that question is, oh, you know, listen, take Here and Now, The Power of Love, take So Amazing, take Never Too Much, take all of my records and put them into one and put them in this generation. That's what this song is. That's how this song is. He said, Harold, which answer going to make you more money? I said, the second one.
Right.
He said, I never forget. He said, Harold, real writers want to be heard. They don't want to be seen. He said, they want to be heard. They don't want to be seen. So over the years, shit, man, I said nothing.
Right.
Because.
Let the work speak for
it. Yeah, you go.
So what did you do?
That the name, when you do that, carries in the proper circles.
Right.
Fans may not know
the people who need to know.
The people who need to know. The A&Rs of the world, they
Come on,
know.
Man. Right.
They know.
Thanks.
So of course, I'm a ghostwriter. Of course I know.
So what happened was.
So what did you do?
So I went from. You know, I found out when you had a hit with Clive, he just kept coming. Mm-hmm. So I just kept.
But backtrack. So Luther says, change the verse.
Yeah.
And he says, this answer is going to make you more money.
Yeah, this answer is going to make you more money. So
and then what happened?
Then we got off the phone. I went to Kinko's. I wrote the verse. Wrote that shit down. Sent it to Kinko. Got it to Kinko. Sent it to the Hit Factory. The wow. one that they had closed down. And
you had to fax it.
I had to fax it. I faxed it.
Wow.
Yeah.
And he kept your... He kept your vocals.
Yeah, and he told. So the next in the next phone call, he said, and his thing was, "You're welcome." He always said, "You're welcome." He said, "Hey, her."
Without you saying thank you.
Yeah, without me saying thank you. He I said, "Hello, is this her?" I said, "Yeah, you're welcome. Listen, take you out as a hit. It's gonna be a hit. You're welcome. Listen, I'm gonna keep your backgrounds. Okay, I like your backgrounds. I like how your voice sound. Okay, you're welcome. Okay." And I was like, "Yes, sir."
So he records, take you out.
Yeah.
Which most people, if you're listening now, it's the song you would think is "Excuse Me, Miss," because it turned into Jay-Z had yes. used it as well. So amazing. So he takes your song, and how did you when you heard Luther singing your words? What did you think?
I felt numb, man. I've been numb ever since. I don't know how that shit feel. Listen, Skills Guru, that was some real shit, bro. Cause I don't even talk. I don't talk a lot.
Right, you don't.
I don't be saying
you definitely
shit.
Don't. I can't believe
that,
I have
that
you.
That I
here.
Know.
Jesus, but I've been numb ever since. Big John told me, he said, "Harold, man, he was like, you know what's gonna happen, bro." He said, "You can't really." I always try to think. I try to start with the end in mind.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
So
right,
I really had a. I have a 30-year plan. I'm just in year 19.
Right.
A 30-year plan.
Right.
So I've been numb. I've been, Jesus, man, from north side of Richmond.
Right.
From 4 years out of high school, five maybe.
Right.
And Luther singing my song on the radio, man. Ever since then, bro, like you said, how you went in the studio and you had legendary figures teaching you.
Right.
You yeah. seen masters at work.
Yeah. Right.
Same
and
shit.
It's just so ironic to me that Luther took the song. The song turns into "Take You Out." He leaves your background on the song. The song, most people remember the song as "Excuse Me, Miss. What's your name? Right, right. Can I come?" And I'm sitting here in the same the connecting of the dots is the guy who wrote the song and the guy who recorded
the song.
Probably
that's crazy.
Arguably the greatest rapper alive. Amen. Redid the song and used the hook, and the guy who recorded that is sitting in the same room.
Facts.
Yo, the crazy part is Jay was on such a run. Like just musically, Pharrell sent the beat, right? Mm-hmm. And the craziest part is all I remember is when we press play, I was like, "Damn, you already know what this hitting for,
right?"
And Hov hit that, "You already know what I'm hitting for, my God, whatever on the Excuse Ooh. Me, man." Like,
I never wow. knew that.
Wow. I said, wow.
I got to give it a, it's y'all can't hear it, but it's applause right now.
I never
for
knew that.
Wow.
He definitely knows how to take just everyday life and throw it in a verse. But that connection like that is just crazy. I got another connection for you. So I'm in Crazy Cat, right? As soon as I get to New York, I left D.C. in 99. I was like, all right, I've done as much as I can down here, or thanks. I'm not moving as fast as I want to move. So I get a call from Derek Angeletti, uh-huh. again, Howard OG.
D-Dot, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
D-Dot. I get this call from D-Dot, right? So I go up there in 99 mm-hmm. and start working for the Mad Rapper, right? Which is Derek Angeletti working on the Mad Rapper album.
Got it. Okay, got it.
Yeah. So when I walk in to do the Mad Rapper album, it's this kid named Kamel in there. That's the first day I meet Kamel.
You know my son named Kamel. Yeah,
bruh, that was one of the deepest connects when, because of the fact that that's the only person that I ever
That's
saw.
How you met Kamel?
That's the first.
Tell me how you met him again.
Meet him, 99. So he was already there. Kamel had came over from Abu Dhabi.
Yep.
After reading The Source. And he started working for D-Dot, but he was working underneath the Ebo.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Right? So when Ebo left Dot, I came up and I started engineering, and that's the first day I met Kamel. But Kamel had already met my whole crew before he met me. He knew Tracy Lee, he knew Quam, he knew Pi, he knew the Reaps, all of them, because they have been coming to the studio. So they have been talking about me, but then I'm coming in there, and then that's the first day I meet Kamel.
Wow.
So it's like the first day of meeting my actual, like, little brother.
Facts, you know what I mean? Bro. Like, yeah,
that's my
man.
Very first day of meeting him. So then the gangster part was that as he's starting to grow, mm-hmm. we left there, you know what I'm saying? We was doing whatever we was doing at Baseline. We do everything that we was doing with Jay, and it was almost like at this point where I felt like it was time for me to kick him out the nest. Yeah. I was like, yo, you too good to be sitting here assisting underneath of me. So as he was going out, you know, trying to find work, as young engineers do at that time, I remember him coming back, and he was so hyped. He was like, yo, I got Harold Lilly.
Wow.
I got Harold Lilly, because I'm working with, I don't know what y'all did that first day. He was like, he called me, he asked for me back. And he was so hyped.
That's crazy.
That you asked for him back. That he was just like, because I'm basically trying to tell him, like, yo, if you stay here, you're going to be my assistant the rest of your life. Like, go, you got to now go get out the nest, bruh.
Right.
Yeah, still.
That's Stu. So Stu was the assistant. That's how legendary the room was.
And people that don't know Stu is Beyonce's personal engineer at this point.
That's crazy.
Yeah, but we shared my dude Kamel passed away, but that was somebody that we shared who came up underneath of me and was like my little brother.
He spoke about you, dog.
I still have a Harold Lilly drive at my house that Kamel had.
Wow.
And they didn't know what to do with all the, you know what I mean? When he passed, they was like, here go all the drives and everything.
Right.
I still have a drive and a box that says Harold Lilly on it from Kamel.
That's crazy, man.
At my crib.
Hey, dog, he was like the best person I ever met, dog. Just inherently good. Yes,
yeah. Right.
Just goodness.
Right, right.
Just goodness.
That's dope, man.
So he would talk about, he would come, I was like, where you? I said, where are you? He said, I just left Baseline. He was like, yo, Earl, I'm working with Guru. I said, you work with Guru. He said, yo, bro, he a master. He a fucking magician. Yo, he's a fucking magician. He said, everything you see me doing, I got from him.
Right.
Everything you see me doing, I got from him. He talked about you, bro.
Oh, man.
Dog, I ain't even going to hold you.
That's dope, man.
We start cutting all these records, Guru.
Yeah.
And we was going crazy up in choir. Me and the Stu. We was going crazy up that bitch, man. And then we did Unpredictable. Big D and Jim Johnson. Shout out to Big D and Jim Johnson, right?
Mm-hmm.
They sent the track. And Breon Prescott.
Right.
Breon sent me the track. Hurl. Hey, you do something on this, it's gone.
Right. Mm-hmm. Unpredictable for Jamie Foxx.
It was Unpredictable for Jamie Foxx. So,
and Luda.
Yeah, so and Luda. And so what happened, bro, it was our rough, but Clive was like, hey, I like how this sound. Mm. Can the engineer take a shot at mixing this?
Mm-hmm.
Can the engineer take a shot? Mm-hmm. And Kamel was like, Earl, I think I got my first mix. Yep. And I'm like, and when he got it, I said, he out of here.
Out of here.
I said, he's out of here.
That's
dope. So, yeah, man, it was beautiful.
Nah, man, listen, I just want to thank both of y'all for coming through.
My yes.
Brother. This has been Hip Hop Confessions with the great, legendary, you know what I'm saying, young guru, Harold Lilly. Listen, I know you don't even do a lot of interviews.
Yeah, this
is
probably
like
the
that.
Last one.
So.
Hey, Skills, but hold up, dog. I got to say this shit, man, because yo, people going to see this on Instagram and shit.
Yes.
Hey, Skills, man, I got one more Hip Hop Confession, man. Listen, bro.
Okay.
Hey, guru, I seen Skills leave Richmond, go to New York City, and it felt like he battled New York. That's what it felt like.
Right.
As a 10th grader. Right. You know what I'm saying? It felt like he battled New York, somebody named Supernatural, some shit. And he went to New York.
It's on YouTube.
By himself. Yes. Dreads and all this energy. And then he came back and he got a record deal. Then he did a video, Broad Street, Cavalier, nigga. You remember that shit?
I do. Sixth Street Marketplace.
So Skills, man, I gotta be honest with you, bro. I want to thank you, man, publicly in front of everybody. Dog. I ain't even here for one for you, dog. You gave me Jodeci. You gave me Wu-Tang. You gave me all that shit, bro. Like, you, I was in church. You kind of was like, no, nigga, listen to this nigga. They old dirty bastard, nigga. This nigga be, right. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, right. You really introduced me to some shit that I probably wasn't going to get otherwise, bro.
Right.
So to all these years later, and you was talking about earlier, man, it's about, it's certain people I ain't never been introduced to.
Right.
You know what
right.
I'm saying? I didn't right. understand it, but right. the more you start talking about right. it, so skills, man, like, I love you, bro. Like,
I love you too,
like,
bro.
Like, I'm not here, bro. I don't meet my cousin, LaKaylee 47.
Right.
If you don't.
That's your cousin?
Yeah.
Yeah. She right there.
Yeah.
It's one of my favorite artists in
yeah,
the world.
Yeah, she said, she signed the hardcover. We, yeah. It's all.
One of my favorite
yeah.
artists in the world.
That's my about this. I gotta tell you a story. Shit is crazy.
Right.
But Skill, right, hey, Skill, I love you, dog.
I love you too.
Hey,
bro.
For real, man. I wanna say that shit to you, man.
I love you too, bro.
Yeah, all right, okay.
You already know. This is Young Guru Harold Lilly, man. My name is Mad Skills. Yeah. We appreciate y'all listening. You already know what it is, man. And this has been Hip Hop Confessions.
Hey.
Cause everybody got one.